Thank you. Hey everybody, welcome to First Wednesday. My name is Kiki.
And I'm John, and we're so glad that you are here tonight to worship together as we take communion and we dive deeper into the scriptures.
Before we start, share the link. We want everybody that needs to be here to be here. So copy that link, send it in a text message, post it on your profile, whatever you need to do to make sure everybody's here that needs to be encouraged tonight.
Now, in addition to that, we want to let you know that later on in the service, we're going to be taking communion together. So we want to give you a heads up to prepare for that. Kiki, how do we do it?
Grab something. Grab grape juice, apple juice, whatever you have in your kitchen, tortilla, bread, cracker.
Anything, apple juice, you know, grape juice, whatever it is, we want to be able to do this together, so make sure that you're prepared for that.
Absolutely. Pastor Bret is bringing a powerful message tonight. He's going to be giving us 3 different reasons we can still praise God despite our circumstances and how we feel, and we'll end with communion and worship. So it's going to be an awesome night, but we're about to get started.
So let's jump into some worship. It's all going to start right now.
Right now.
Now the darkness fades into new beginnings as we lift our with an expectation to declare the reign of the Lord our God. Now the silence breaks Can stand it.
is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at his feet we bow. The one who wore our sin and shame, now robed in majesty, the radiance of perfect love, now shines for your name.
Your name is big. Well, welcome to First Wednesday, everybody. And it's so great to worship with you online and to bless God's name, to praise His name. At a time like this, when we all have difficulties in our life and situations that are hard, it's hard to be thankful. It's hard to just trust God with all the details and to trust Him with the future. I want to encourage you tonight as we worship the Lord to really step out and bless His holy name. We're going to look at a psalm, Psalm 103, that does that very thing. So if you have your Bible, open up to Psalm 103 and let's go through it together. And I really want to share with you reasons why we can thank God tonight, reasons why we can praise God tonight, and reasons why from the depth of our being, we ought to sing loud and worship Him. The scripture really goes beyond circumstances. In our world, usually people are happy or thankful or grateful when something good happens circumstantially. You know, my job, I get a raise at my job, or a medical report comes back and it's better than expected, or, you know, the economy finally turns around and my 401k is doing better, whatever it might be. Usually in the world, some kind of circumstance changes and therefore people are happy or thankful or grateful. But the scripture goes far beyond circumstances, way beyond it. Because the scripture knows, God knows, that circumstances come and go. Circumstances are good sometimes and bad other times. I want to give you a reason why you can worship God in your heart and thank God in your heart tonight beyond any circumstances, whether good or bad. Psalm 103 begins this way. The writer is King David, who, if you know anything about David's life, you can read about it in 1 and 2 Samuel in the Old Testament. David had many different circumstances, some good ones, some bad ones. But he says in verse 1, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, my soul, and forget not all His benefits." Now, I want to give you some of those benefits tonight, which are the reason why David is blessing the Lord. What does it mean to bless the Lord? Well, the word, the Hebrew word, means to give thanks. It means to bow down. It's to acknowledge God. And so to bless the Lord means to think through and remember all that God has done for you and all that God has done in our life and what He's given us by His grace and by His mercy. And that's what King David recounts. And he recounts it, the blessings of God, the benefits of God, that evokes a praise in him. He does it, he says, from all that is within him. All that is within him. Sometimes we thank God, you know, for things that are food, or we thank God for things getting better in our life, or that we can finally go to a park, or we can get outside, or whatever. But David is blessing the Lord and thanking the Lord from deep within his soul, deep within his soul. And I want to encourage you to do that tonight. First thing he thanks God for in verses 3 and 4, and then I want to look at verses 10 and to 12, is he thanks God for the forgiveness we have. Who forgives, verse 3, all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy. And then down in verses 10 and 11, he says, he does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. God has forgiven us our sins. God remembers our sins no more. God doesn't treat us as our sins deserve, nor repay us according to our iniquities. That's his mercy. That's his grace. You know, no matter what you're going through tonight, no matter what your emotions are tonight, no matter what the future holds for you or for me tonight, and we really don't know, no matter what it is that is in our life right now, you know what we can bless the Lord and thank him for and praise his holy name about? That he's forgiven us. He's forgiven us. We have mistakes. Every one of us have mistakes in our life. Every one of us has sin in our life. Things that we wish we hadn't done, things that we're feeling bad about, maybe things that haunt us, memories of things we've chosen in our past or maybe in our very recent history that we know are wrong, that we know are not right before God. You know, the scripture says that God doesn't treat us as those sins deserve. Because Jesus paid for our sins on the cross, and because Jesus shed his blood on the cross, we've been taken from the pit, you know, and raised out of that pit and brought into a place of abundance and love and steadfast mercy from God. The book of Ephesians says that while we were dead in our transgressions and sins, God, through his mercy, has raised us up with Christ and seated us in heavenly places, like from death all the way to being seated with Christ, from the pit to being in a place of steadfast love from God. Why? Because of his great mercy for us. I love verse 12 describing this forgiveness. He says, as far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As far as the east is from the west. How far is the east from the west? Well, if you go on a straight line east, you just keep going. You never get west. We're not talking about circling the earth and going east and then coming around. No, that's not what he's talking about. To eventually west, like, oh yeah, God forgives my sins, and then he comes around and he makes me give an account for my sins. No, that's not what he's saying. Go on a straight line east, as far as the east is from the west, so far as God removed your sins from you. How far is that? It's an eternal distance. If you go east on a straight line, you never get west. And so God doesn't bring up our sins to us. On the day of judgment, because you've been covered by the blood of Jesus Christ and the payment of Jesus Christ, your sins are never brought up to you. There's no condemnation for us in Christ Jesus. God's not going to ask you to, you know, you remember when you did that, or you remember when you did that? God forgets our sins. He removes them from us. As one writer put it, you're not on parole with God, you've been pardoned. You know, if you're on parole, some of criminals, you know, on parole, it means they got to keep checking in, right, with the parole officer. Sometimes they have an ankle bracelet that dictates everywhere they go. And if they go outside of the boundary, then it's reported and a parole officer shows up. You're not on parole with God. You've been pardoned. You've been washed, cleansed. That's something that no matter what your circumstance is tonight, you can just pause and you can go, thank you, God, for your grace and for your undeserved favor and your mercy. Now, he goes on in this psalm, there's so much, and he says, secondly, the good things that God has brought into our life. Praise his name for that. Thank him for that, the good things that he does bring into our life. In verse 5, he satisfies you with good so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. You know, that given the ups and downs of all our emotions right now, the ups and downs of our circumstances, God brings those good things in, doesn't he? To renew you, keep you going. You know, there's the call from the friend or the unexpected meal that comes to your door. We've had two of our neighbors bring over fresh baked bread to us. It's been a long time since I've had like fresh baked bread. That's the reason you can't find flour when you go to the grocery store. Everybody's making bread. But that was just a blessing, you know, and I loved it. Just putting a toaster, bread that's like special stuff, and it's like the goodness of God, the surprises. You know, the online services, I hope they've been an encouragement to you. I was telling some of our staff that I've been able to worship God in a unique way through those online services. When the band starts and we're drawn in and we're worshiping, it's like, I don't know, it feels to me like the gospel's triumphing, the gospel's going out, and God's got this. There's something about the worship online that is especially meaningful to me, and it's the goodness of God. Even though we're in trials and difficulty, it brings good things into our life. It says that it renews us, these good things. And it's like the eagle. He renews your youth like the eagle. I did some study about eagles. You know, they live about 60 years. 60 or 70 years. And right about year 30, they go up into the mountains and they sort of hide themselves and they renew themselves. And the way they do it is they literally will knock off their old beak in order to start the growth of a new beak. They'll take off their claws so that they grow new claws, and they'll pull out their own feathers in order to grow new feathers. And then being renewed, they go on from age 30 all the way to like age 70. The youth, the eagle, what an amazing picture. God brings good things into your life at the time you need it. And I hope tonight is one of those times for you. He brings good things into your life at the time you need it to renew you like the eagle. You know, the eagle is strong. The eagle can see another eagle flying from 50 miles away. An eagle can see another eagle flying right now from Santa Rosa to San Francisco. Think about that. They can see a little mouse on the ground from a mile away. So God is bringing good things into your life to renew you. Every good and perfect thing comes down from God. He knows when you need it, and he'll bring it to you. He's so good. And then the third thing I just want to give you from Psalm 103 tonight is this, that God brings compassion into your life. He's compassionate toward you. He's compassionate. Verse 13 and 14, as a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him, for he knows our frame and he remembers that we are dust. Do you know that God is compassionate towards you, and he knows your weaknesses, and he knows your frame, that you're dust? I think of Jesus when he told the disciples in the Garden of Gethsemane. He said, you know, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. That's when Jesus faced the prospect of the cross, and he was praying to his Father, and if it be possible, take this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. He tells the disciples, the flesh is weak. The scripture says in the book of Hebrews that we don't have a high priest who can't sympathize with our weaknesses. Jesus Christ can sympathize with your weakness. He knows them. Scripture says he's been tempted in all ways as we are, but without sin. And so come boldly to the throne of grace to find mercy and help in your time of need. As the Father is compassionate on his children, so God is compassionate towards you. Compassionate. He understands. You know, he's not demanding. He's not like, come on, you should do better. When our daughter was just 3 years old, she fed our cat, and she gave our cat a half a box of cat food. Now, the cat loved it. And I told our daughter, tried to explain to her as a three-year-old that cats don't get that much food to eat. And I remember her saying to me, and I wrote it down because I pulled this out of my notes. She said, but he's still hungry, Dad. He's still hungry. From her little thinking and rationale at a three-year-old level, she thought the cat, you know, should just keep eating. All right. I picture the cat saying, hey, leave her alone. She's doing a good thing. All right. But I didn't shame her out. You know, I didn't say, come on, you should know better. And cat food is expensive. And you should be, you know, able to discern and be able to think this through. Cats can't eat a half a box, you know, which would have led to other problems, right? And when a kid is a kid, you treat him as a kid. They have three-year-old emotions, three-year-old understanding. You know what? Let me just say, as a father has compassion on his children, so God has compassion on you. He knows your weaknesses, and he knows you're growing in your relationship to him, and he knows that you're not going to get it right all the time. And he's compassionate towards that. Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad about the compassion of God? He doesn't treat us as our sins deserve. He gives us good things in order to renew us. He forgives all of our sins. Won't you join with me tonight in saying to the Lord, bless you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Lord, for who you are. You know, seven times in this psalm, the psalmist says, bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. I love the way the psalm ends. Verse 20. Bless the Lord, O you, his angels, you mighty ones who do his word, obeying the voice of his word. Angels, praise the Lord. Thank the Lord. Verse 21. All his hosts, his ministers who do his will, bless the Lord. Verse 22. This is how the psalm ends. Bless the Lord, all his works, all creation, in all places of his dominion, in heaven and below, above, the heavens above, below the earth, doesn't matter where you are, in all places of his dominion, throughout all his work, bless the Lord, O my soul. King David went through a lot in his life. He was king. He saw a lot of the blessings of God, the goodness of God. He saw the forgiveness of God. Remember, it was King David who committed adultery with Bathsheba and ordered the murder of her husband Uriah to try to cover the whole thing up. It was David who suffered within his family and had many struggles and circumstances that are like unbearable when you read his story. It's David who writes this psalm and says, no matter what I go through or what I've been through, God never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And the blessings that come to us in Jesus Christ never change. No circumstance can undo them. No future possibility can take them away from you because they're coming to you by grace and in Christ. Let's praise God and thank him tonight. Lord, we love you. And from the deepest part of our being, we praise your holy name. You are so good to us. In Jesus' name, we thank you. Amen. Now we're going to take communion. I want to let you get some communion elements tonight, some bread, maybe some fresh baked bread that somebody gave you. But get some bread to represent the broken body of Christ and then a cup, perhaps of juice or whatever you have for your family, you know, around. And we're going to take communion tonight. And because Jesus said to us on the night he's betrayed, you know, to take bread and get the cup in order to remember what he's done for us. I love the phrase in Psalm 103, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. The communion is one of the ways that we remember. And it's for us. I believe Jesus gave the communion service, the communion elements to his disciples, and then therefore to us since the first century, so that we would remember that we are forgiven of all our sins, that we would remember that God has compassion on us, that we would remember that he brings good things into our life. As Romans chapter 8 says, if God didn't spare his own son for us, how will he not also with him freely give us all things? So let's take the bread and remember that the broken bread symbolizes the broken body of Jesus on the cross for you and for me, for the forgiveness of sins. Let's eat it in remembrance of him. On that same night, that Passover night, the Last Supper, before Jesus was crucified, he took the cup. And he told his disciples, this is the new covenant in my blood. Drink it in remembrance of me. Christ shed his blood for you. He shed his blood for me for the forgiveness of sins. Take it and remember all his benefits. God, we thank you for the communion. Thank you for giving it to us. We love you. And from the deepest part of our soul tonight, our innermost being, we bless your holy name. In Jesus' name, amen.
I could not climb. Of kingdom come, So don't let your heart be troubled. Hold your head up high, don't fear no evil. Fix your eyes on this one truth. God is madly in love with you. So take courage, hold on, be strong. Remember where our help comes from. Say, oh. light of heaven, friend forever, his kingdom come.